Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents American Audacity, in Defense of Literary Daring, by William Giraldi. Read by Stephen Graybill. Introduction. American Audacity. In the 7 years I spent producing this book, I was never pestered by the awareness of being an American writer with strictly American themes to pursue. Beware of those who are pushy on the point of their own nationality. And yet when it came time to confront my critical work, to cull and then shape some of it into a coherent mass, I had no other choice but to see how American I've been all along, in my sensibility, my concerns, my conception of literature and self. Perhaps we American writers are helpless not to pulse with our own Americanness. The national ethos is too much with us, our brief history too manifest, our media-born manias too destructive and distracting. But my critical work didn't necessarily begin that way. My critical work began with two Brits. In graduate school at Boston University in the early aughts, I enrolled in a seminar with the eminent English poet-critic Geoffrey Hill. A semester-long agon with the verse and theology of Father Gerard Manley Hopkins. I was the only fiction writer in a room full of poets with academic aspirations, poets who regarded me, I feared, as something of an unwelcome oddity. One told me that she didn't quite understand what a fiction writer wanted from Hopkins and Hill. If you're thinking how resoundingly obvious it is that a fiction writer can benefit from the intense study of a poet, I've found that some among us eschew the resoundingly obvious. Perhaps the bafflement emerges from the fact that the inverse won't exactly hold. Poets have less to learn from novelists, since their principal aim is the architecture of the auditory and not the agency of character and narrative. Anyway, Hill took me aside one afternoon to let me know that I didn't have what it took to be a tweed, didn't have the conformist mettle and turbid prose of the average academic, but that I might have some luck as a reviewer or literary essayist for the common reader, as Dr. Johnson meant it. Hill sent me home that day with a pile of essays from the American poet critics he most revered, T.S. Eliot, R.P. Blackmer, Yvore Winters, Alan Tate, John Crow Ransom, though much of what I'd learn about literary comment would come directly from Hill himself, from taking in his mode of evaluating Hopkins's verse, his fertile insights into how the words function in their stanzas and lines, singly and in pairs, and how Hopkins's religio-political vision breathes, expands in his rhythms. It remains the most transformative classroom encounter of my life. Hill's was an effortlessly severe intensity, vigorous apprehending by a mammoth intellect, a man regarded by many, including Donald Hall and Harold Bloom, as the greatest English poet of his generation. His rhapsodical denunciations of inferior writing could send giddy fear rippling through the room. He once read aloud a new poem by a much-decorated American poet that had just appeared in a much-decorated American magazine, and at the end of it declared, in that frightfully beautiful Worcestershire brogue, "There are perhaps two words and a comma which I wouldn't be utterly ashamed to have written." And then he went through the poem, syllable by syllable, period by period, and explained why and how each was the wrong choice. But to hear him give praise to Hopkins and the other literary giants who mattered to him, to have written that, my God, was an unforgettable tutorial in the efficacy of literary love. Much of his criticism, though I write mostly on prose, has been an effort to enact the standards I learned from Hill, a struggle to become somewhat worthy of his tremendous example, and also a remembrance of the kindness he showed to me. After the seminar, he tolerated my youth's pesky gusto for another semester during weekly sessions at his office. He always wore a black sweatsuit painted in white cat hair, where he guided me through the roiling labyrinth of Hopkins's great long poem, The Wreck of the Deutschland. When Hill died too soon in 2016, the world became a much darker, duller place for me. I still hear his voice daily. Most fiction writers at the entrance gate of their careers quickly see that no one is all that eager to pay them for their stories, but I saw that I could cover a few monthly bills with a 1,200-word review. With Hill's help, I sold my first essay review that same semester on the Russian writer Tatiana Tolstaya to the fabled Partisan Review, which then promptly shut down operation before my piece could be published. But a paycheck showed up in the mail anyway. Indeed, enough to cover a bill. And since then, I've gone on having bills. Criticism doesn't pay very much, but it does pay something. And those of us with greedy little mouths at home will take what we can get. Still, the critic best have some other motive, some other need that's fulfilled by entering the arena of literary comment. For some, that need assumes dignity by morphing into duty. The critic is a reader before he is a writer, a spirited lover of literature, and criticism is one important use to which he puts his reading and his love. To sit before literature in appreciation and awe, to want to have some hand in facilitating literature's efficacy, to comprehend that literature is, in Kenneth Burke's phrase, equipment for living, a means of enlargement and enhancement and understanding. These are the critic's prerequisites. The critic should be tethered to no theory, no ideology, no asphyxiating ism. Like the poet and novelist, he should be of no party. Ideology is the enemy of art because ideology is the end of imagination. The critic's chief loyalty is to the duet of beauty and wisdom, to the well-made and usefully wise, and to the ligatures between style and meaning. Literature is read and criticism written in defiance of the ongoing noise, the ceaseless cyber-grading and reckless surrender of calm, and in defense of those solitary spots where a person desires to conquer the great wilderness of himself, as James Baldwin has it, the great wilderness that gives up its secrets only by way of an inquisitive hush, a whispered inwardness in which we can be wholly ourselves. Perhaps the primary distinction of the artist, Baldwin writes, is that we must actively cultivate that state which most men necessarily must avoid, the state of being alone. The cultivation of aloneness is the primary distinction of the reader and critic, too. If, as Goethe believed, the artist must have a touch of audacity in order to make art, I learned from Jeffrey Hill what I'd soon find in Baldwin, Mary McCarthy, Elizabeth Hardwick, and the others who have become my lodestars, a conviction that the critic must have audacity, too. What does a particularly American audacity look like? In the opening essay of Nobody Knows My Name, The Discovery of What It Means to Be an American, James Baldwin begins with an axiom from his beau ideal Henry James. It is a complex fate to be an American, and then imparts this bit of Baldwinian insight. America's history, her aspirations, her peculiar triumphs, her even more peculiar defeats, and her position in the world, yesterday and today, are all so profoundly and stubbornly unique that the very word American remains a new, almost completely undefined, and extremely controversial proper noun. No one in the world seems to know exactly what it describes, not even we millions who call ourselves Americans. We might not know exactly what American describes, but we've gone on describing it, or trying to. Ever since a clan of audacious rebels accomplished an act of extreme imagination and wrote this nation into being, America has been pressed to define itself, to establish its selfhood, through its language and its literature, and whatever character matches its outsized ambitions. we perpetually find ourselves in a whirling state of self-invention and self-description. The American ethos, struggling for articulation and fixed on the present, is necessarily obsessed with itself. Our literature, like our vast character, puts an unswayable emphasis on what being American means. A people always seemingly sundered in our political, cultural, and regional loyalties. Americans are also, as Gore Vidal never tired of pointing out, an amnesiac nation. Wherever else they are, Americans are unapologetically in the now and racing toward tomorrow. Elizabeth Hardwick puts it this way: "The American situation is not so much to overthrow the past as to overthrow the future before it arrives as a stasis. We are new and getting newer all the time." America began in Audacity. We're a union of escapees toiling toward our own authenticity. Reach back before the audacity of Southern secession, of the westward pioneers, of Lewis and Clark, of the Revolution, of the Declaration, and look to the audacity of those first settlers, storming this already occupied Jeshimon, believing their inscrutable Lord had willed it, wanted it for them, an overdue deliverance in this new world. Seeking to create something from a perceived nothing, this land was supposedly the reward for their Puritan piety. Their suffering was otherworldly. The suffering they inflicted was otherworldly, too. It takes audacity to welcome such suffering. It takes audacity to dish it. Their enthusiastic anguish was a signal of election. Fulfilling God's blueprint in the new world was supposed to be God-awful, stained from the womb, born blighted, inclined toward what Calvin liked to call concupiscence. They spent both their waking and resting hours monitored by an exacting God who created them in a state that he then instructed them to deny. It was tough work, their pilgrimhood, but they took to it. James Baldwin is always reminding us that America was founded from the rumblings and gratings of these Puritans, from the earnest reaching of their Calvinist soul and mind. To embrace and to deny them is our legacy. Disparaging the Puritans in his still relevant In the American Grain, William Carlos Williams says that their misfortune has become a malfeasant ghost that dominates us all. Writing on Stephen Crane in 1960, Ralph Ellison argues that the puritanical brand of Christianity is not only subject matter for 20th century literature, but is a major source of its technique, its form, and rhetoric. Remember how T.S. Eliot described himself late in life? A Catholic cast of mind, a Calvinist heritage, and a Puritan temperament. And when today's Christian right-wingers gloat that America has Christianity thriving in its DNA, they aren't exactly wrong, though they certainly are in thinking that the essential founders were Christ-drunk churchgoers who wanted the rest of us to be, too. For all their gaudy humility, the Puritans were an audacious lot, convinced that they were central to God's concerns, savage concerns they were forever trying to divine, savage concerns that frequently killed them. Here is Increase Mather, father of Cotton Mather, and please do pardon his modesty. Some of us are under special advantage to understand these mysterious truths of God. As to what Mather called their exiled condition in this wilderness, they chose the exile and they chose the wilderness. By the Puritans' strangling of logic, God harassed them in the new world, not because he despised them, but because he loved them. Just look at what he did to his darling Job. Today, it's difficult for us to fathom how pressingly immediate God was to these people. He was their internet, everywhere and inescapable, watching them as they slept. The Gospels were their Google. Original sin was not a detail of dogma. They could feel it in their blood and lungs. You can glimpse the frontier lonesomeness and ecstatic Calvinist self-abnegation of the first American poets of note, colonials Anne Bradstreet and Edward Taylor. Bradstreet is a special case in American letters. An overdoting wife and mother of too many children, she was determined, against the outrageous strictures of her time, to invent herself as a poet, and she did. We know precisely what harassed and heartened the Pilgrims because we have William Bradford's Of Plymouth Plantation, composed between 1630 and 1650. The first outright literary work penned in America in English, the supernal story of survival, piety, death, it pleased God to visit us with death daily, and eventual failure after almost 50 years of some truly fervid trying. We have written accounts from the older Jamestown and the stouter Massachusetts Bay colonies, too, but neither of those was blessed with a Bradford. What ended the strivings of the Plymouth settlers was perhaps what's become a stereotypical American flaw: ardent individualism, a breakdown of communal duty, everyone's concern for himself, his own property, his own pocketbook. America, the self-begotten, land of the career individual and moneymaker, we are all of us atoms in the morning. Noah Webster in 1825. American glory begins at the dawn. Yes, it does. A hemorrhage of sun and blood and hope. American literary sensibility evolved from an artful collision of several forces: the ambitions and dreads of the Puritans, the newness and menace of the land, the values of the European Renaissance, and later, the unignorable notions of the European Enlightenment. There was a pregnant tension there from the start, and in the 18th century that tension was embodied in Jonathan Edwards on the one side and Benjamin Franklin on the other. Edwards's species of romantic Puritanism would later influence the American Transcendentalists and also the ecstatic terror in Moby Dick, that reliable Puritan itch to allergize, to behold everything through the vista of cosmic significance. Personal narrative. Edwards's own foray into Augustinian confession makes a tidy antithesis to Franklin's autobiography. The one, a hymn to the individual soul's responsibility. The other, an homage to the individual mind in society. Edwards wrapped in the ideal and spiritual, Franklin in the actual and practical. Jay Gatsby, says Nick Carraway, sprang from his platonic conception of himself. It's our most enduring cliché, the prevalence of which has derived, in large part, from the enterprising flair of Franklin, his shrewd self-mythologizing. In America, you get to make yourself and then make yourself anew if you want, if you must. D.H. Lawrence, Franklin was the first downright American. We're not cubicled by class or title. Democracy allots us an enlarging sense of personal agency, and never mind if that sense is mostly illusory. Never mind if a galling number of Americans can't be bothered to vote. Gore Vidal's dauntless cynicism enjoyed saying that America is run by neither the plain people nor the politicians, but by the banks and corporations, and you'll have to decide for yourself how accurate that is, how democratic we actually are. If William Bradford commits himself to a plain style with singular regard unto the simple truth of things, 2 centuries later, Emerson in his journals refers to the plain old Adam, the simple genuine self against the whole world. Compare that to Whitman's One's Self I Sing, a simple separate person. It's curious to see early American writers concerned with plainness and simplicity when we think of ourselves, or should, as toweringly complex and multiform. And when many others around the globe now look on us as ostentatious, obnoxious, narcissistic, and simple as in simplistic. Emerson's guiding creed says that the self's individual agency is the principal characteristic of Americanness, which is why Whitman believed that Emerson is the actual beginner of the whole American procession. He's not, or not exactly, but you see what Whitman is getting at. After being influenced by a battalion of European poets and philosophers, Emerson was loudest in admonishing our writers to find spark from within our own feral Americanness. We have listened too long to the courtly muses of Europe. Melville would come to believe much the same thing. From that Emersonian angle, Melville's Ahab is the most audaciously American character in our canon. His steely self-belief won't be weakened by water or fire, beast or man. To his own detriment, he won't be influenced. Melville might have confected Ahab from the grammar of the King James Version, the heft of Shakespeare's tragedies, and the lightning of Milton's Satan, to say nothing of Homer and Virgil. But Ahab is touched with Puritan New World fire, in that his quest is a holy quest, a holiness of blasphemy, but a holiness just the same. There's a Puritan wandering in the wilderness, a seeking after whale-sized truths, a passing through terror and death in order to fulfill God's plan in the world. Ahab is the satanic god of a ship, in order to bolster the belief in providence, an ode to struggle and woe in which the world is shot through with divine and demonic signals. In its antinomian tenor, its tremendous seeing, Moby Dick takes the pilgrim conception of a howling wilderness, a murderous natural arena of creatures and savages, and transposes it to the sea. With its volcanic tongue, its deadly exuberance of expression, the novel contains what William Carlos Williams calls, in a different context, the whole weight of the wild continent. Camille Paglia refers to its operatic gigantism, which could be describing the country itself. It's exceedingly American to need the great American novel, and lucky for us, we have it. Moby Dick is the great American novel, because it is the only American novel whose vision is enormous enough and religious enough to contain our American enormity and prevailing religiosity. Paul Bowles once said that he couldn't abide Moby Dick because one needs to be religious in order to do so, and perhaps that's true enough. The pilgrims might have been very bent Christians, but they were not, of course, American at all. They were stubbornly English and European, though not for long. We might recall here Twain's calumny against our former countrymen. The English are people who do something because it's been done before. Americans are people who do something because it hasn't. Hardwick says that Americans are forever trying to make a rock out of a waterfall. It would take another generation or two after the pilgrims for our American individuality, our staunch otherness, to emerge, and another century before that staunch otherness led to revolution and war. This is what D.H. Lawrence means in Studies in Classic American Literature when he speaks of the true myth of America. She starts old, old, wrinkled and writhing in an old skin, and there is a gradual sloughing off of the old skin towards a new youth. That remains the urgent American appeal, a vaunting juvenescence forever renewable and always stretching for self-actualization. America's youth, says Wilde, is our best and oldest tradition. We're obsessed with youth, yes, but to be obsessed with youth is to be in awe of life. Lawrence's influential little book on American literature is a typically Lawrencean performance, largely ridiculous. American writers are serpents and demons. Emily Dickinson isn't worthy of mention. Edgar Allan Poe is a vampire. Walt Whitman, a knave, etc. But it's peppered with acute insights only an outsider could have made, an understanding of a key aspect of American character. What's so distinctive about American literature? Lawrence speaks with grudging esteem of an American extremity of consciousness, typified by Poe, Melville, Hawthorne, and Whitman, an American intensity of apprehension joined to a robust seeking of selfhood. But there's something else, violence. The American, says Lawrence, has got to destroy It is his destiny, because the essential American soul is hard, isolate, stoic, and a killer. Just consider at the Orestes-like frenzy of restlessness in the Yankee soul, the inner malaise that amounts almost to madness. Just consider the menace in the landscape. He could have gone further with that assertion because our nation was founded in violence, the violence the first settlers inflicted upon natives and the violence those natives returned. The violence of climate, the violence of revolution, the violence of slavery, and the violence of the war that ended it. Perhaps no nation can be carpentered without the dumping of blood, but the young American soil is particularly soaked with it. This brute youth, Emerson calls us, and how fitting that what have become the two most glaring symbols of Americanness are also causes of staggering violence by the hour, the firearm and the automobile. That violent legacy is vivified in Melville and Stephen Crane, in Faulkner and Hemingway, in Flannery O'Connor and Richard Wright, and among living writers most triumphantly in Cormac McCarthy. Violence wed to rootlessness, the pathological quality of our most vital literature, Dickinson and Death, Whitman and Democracy, Ahab and the Whale, Huck Finn and the River, Cather and the Frontier, O'Connor and Christ, Bellow and the Intellect, Ellison and Whiteness, Baldwin and the Soul, Cormac McCarthy and Murder, derives from an essential rootlessness, Melville's Landlessness, from always being recently born. Call it the neuroticism of national youth, of having to create your total being from such short history, from such a pulsating inheritance. In a 1967 lecture called The Novel as a Function of American Democracy, Ralph Ellison says this, "As I see it, the novel has always been bound up with the idea of nationhood. What are we? Who are we? And if that's mostly true for all nations, it's especially true for America. Though, of course, that truth is not limited to the novel only. Our poems, plays, and essays also confront the conundrums of nationhood. And in the case of Whitman, without Leaves of Grass, American selfhood would be a fallow affair." Ellison also believes that the American nation is based upon revolution. It certainly is, though revolution is only one-third of the American triumvirate that includes independence and democracy, a triumvirate most ecstatically at work in Whitman. He and Dickinson remain our most audacious poets. Dickinson's nerve in the grimace of death, her daring within what she calls the dark parade, has not been equaled in our literature. She looks the reaper in the black hole of his hood and will not blink. For sheer literary guts, Whitman has nothing on Dickinson. I once overheard Derek Walcott say that although Whitman has become our national bard, Dickinson is more deserving of that title. Her metaphysics heave within the strictness of her form, such a supreme poetic discipline, such deliberate craft, all those gravid dashes. Because she is our great poet of death, she understands that she must also be our great poet of God, whom she calls our old neighbor, who cannot be found. It takes something more than audacity. It takes Greek-level hubris to be the great poet of God when you will not believe in him. In his shimmering American Renaissance of 1941, F.O. Matheson remarks that the five-year sweep from 1850 to 1855 hosted the publication of seven essential books: Representative Men, The Scarlet Letter, The House of the Seven Gables, Moby Dick, Pierre, Walden, and Leaves of Grass. You might, says Matheson, search all the rest of American literature without being able to collect a group of books equal to these in imaginative vitality. Before that onslaught of imaginative vitality, and let's remember that phrase, readers had to content themselves with the derivative thinness of Washington Irving and with the breathless frontier romances and criminal verbosities of Fenimore Cooper, to say nothing of his legion of lagging imitators. It's a bit of a chore now to read Irving and Cooper next to Poe. With Poe, something truly other, truly disruptive, burst to life in American letters, a conceptual quake from which we're still recovering. Poe is a boldness so discomposing we're still trying to figure out what to do with it. His interment of the familiar and his corpus-wide denial of daylight. The preceding era of Irving seems a yawn, gossamer in comparison. When Hemingway uttered that oft-cited line about all modern American literature stemming from Huckleberry Finn, he wasn't being factual, but you take his point. He means Twain's prose, that waltzing American dialect and its folksy versatility, the first true instance of our literature fully embracing the linguistic grit and pitch of Americanese. The unprecedented nativism of Huck's tongue is a songful animation of William Bradford's plain style of two centuries before. See the demonic fuse burning from Huck to Ring Lardner and Sherwood Anderson to Hemingway himself and Robert Frost, and the two Raymonds, Chandler and Carver. The novel's satirical boldness would help incite the following century's two boldest American comedies, Catch-22 and Portnoy's Complaint. Just as crucial, Huckleberry Finn employs the most binding affirmation of morality in all of American letters, when Huck refuses to turn Jim over to the scoundrels hunting him, and instead consigns his own soul to hellfire. The uncut audacity of that decision, the humanistic punch of it. There was not before, and has not been since, a more gladiatorial American critic of America, not even Mencken or Baldwin. Twain wields his humor as a comedian should, as both bludgeon and gavel. Against the assault of laughter, nothing can stand. Add to his artistic achievement his foxy cultivation of celebrity, and you have the most American author ever to pick up a pen. He makes Henry James look French. If Hemingway's language revolutionized American fiction, and if his own celebrity out-testosteroned Twain's, neither the language nor the celebrity would have been all that likely without Twain's example. We all have our personally vetted lists of daring ones, the Faulkners and Flannery O'Connors, the Dorothy Parkers and James Baldwins, who refused to compromise their visions, who dared not just to make it new, but to make it true, make it lovely and wise, allying the enigmas of spirit to the avowals of heart and mind, and always in a prose that knows it must do double work, reaching within and without. One must write into the language as a bird takes off into flight, discovering itself in the act of its own soaring. The daring ones are always helpless to do otherwise. Consider Dreiser, jumping in to correct the often sentimental and anodyne social record put down by novelists such as William Dean Howells. Henry James gives us consummate interiorities, past and wills so intricate, so exquisitely honeycombed, he makes many previous novelists look lacking in their tiny, fitful revelations. The sheer artistic impudence of William Faulkner, the sass and swagger of it, he begot the 20th century's most triumphant American fiction from the incalculable humiliations of the South's defeat. Flannery O'Connor clutches her Roman Catholicism and into the Protestant South unleashes her primal howls of understanding. Eliot drops the tremendous bomb that begins American modernist poetry, that frontal assault on poetic propriety, and our whole mode of cultural comprehension, the wasteland. Ralph Ellison annexes a troupe made popular by H.G. Wells and gives us a man so elaborately invisible we can never again not see him. That is the potency of our most lasting literature. A revolution in apprehension. There's a prevalent and false golden age nostalgia, which wants us to believe that America used to be a more literate and literary land. Before the internet, before television, before radio, before photography, before the phonograph. But Hawthorne thought the reading public suckers for trash and the publishing industry a gaggle of greedy cynics. Emerson was of the view that people do not deserve good writing, they are so pleased with bad. Melville passed his last decades in a cobweb of obscurity. Newton Arvin, still Melville's best critic, says that the public's treatment of him is the most appalling literary crime in American history. One of Henry Adams's pet phrases is, "The public be damned," because it is neither literary nor intelligent enough. Poe was forever starving. He couldn't earn a living with his pen, and railed against the crooked market feeding low appetites. Longfellow got rich from his jingles, yes, but he was rich anyway, thanks to his marriage. And the money he made from his poems, he made mostly because he was a cunning businessman, not because he was a sublime and daring maker of verse. Here's James Baldwin in 1961. There are long moments when this country resembles nothing so much as the grimmest of popularity contests. My point is involved with the great emphasis placed on public approval here, and the resulting and quite insane system of penalties and rewards. It puts a premium on mediocrity and has all but slaughtered any concept of excellence. Literary daring involves the principled repudiation of that insane system, much more insane now than in Baldwin's day, and a return to excellence. One need not be an alarmist to understand that the danger is real now, godlike and unprecedented, all-powerful and everywhere. The internet has zapped us all into obliging zombies. It makes yesterday's threat from television look whimsical and rather cute. In the sordid smoke of this e-bombardment, American literature must reach back as it works ahead. It must do what literature has always done, facilitate those silent spaces, remain steadfastly itself in its employment of slowness, interiority, grace, and in its marshalling of aesthetic sophistication and complexity. Writers must exert an archaic mindfulness. They must resist a relinquishing of the past and a disprizing of standards. They must insist on memory, and they must insist on influence. F.O. Matheson speaks of imaginative vitality, and that's precisely what American literature in the 21st century must aspire to. Mystery, ecstasy, theodicy, the sublime manifest in language. The Scarlet Letter, says Hawthorne, performs its magic somewhere between the real world and fairyland, where the actual and the imaginary may meet, and each imbues itself with the nature of the other. And that seems to be the right recipe for fiction. Ralph Ellison writes that the novelist has an obligation to tell the truth, to describe with eloquence and imagination life as it appears from wherever he finds his being. I want to underscore Ellison's pairing of eloquence with imagination, because for the novelist, as for the poet, each is neutered without the other. Literature both leads us forth from ourselves and returns us to ourselves. It cares nothing for the validation of identity, only for the upending of it. Great books are not echo chambers for our own personalities. We go to them precisely because, in their most sublime moments, they allow us to partake of what we are not and can never be. We go to them for the fact of their humanity and for their pages that croon of our rescue from the pat and patently false. We can recall here Ishmael's immortal dictum aboard the Pequod. To produce a mighty book, you must choose a mighty theme. But of course, theme alone won't do, just as experience alone is not enough. If writers must undertake an Eliotic retreat from experience or personality in order to make art, recall Eliot's program in Tradition and the Individual Talent, literature is a shunning of mere personality, then they must also accept that without a vibrancy of language, without an assertive style of mind, theme means nothing. James Baldwin makes that admonition again and again. What good are protest novels, he asks, if they are shoddily built, if the prose is a tangle of platitudes? A necessary distinction must be drawn between those American books that are important for social reasons, Uncle Tom's Cabin, Mary Antin's The Promised Land, Upton Sinclair's The Jungle, and those American books that are important because they are aesthetically audacious, daring in their form and mind, ferocious in their beauty, because they are, in a word, literature. Without its literature, a nation is an impotent actor in its own drama. American stories and poems are the engine of our national myths that show us ourselves and through which we begin to understand the pith of our character and the boundaries of our striving and sin. Ralph Ellison in 1957, the novelist must take chances or die. Yes, he must. In the essays and reviews that follow, I've tried always to take my own chances and to deal, in some way, with how a book is made, its sentences, its narratives, its notions, and how they coalesce to form a book's armature. I've tried to have an acute responsiveness to style and mind. If I can be said to have a method as a critic, it is Matheson's In American Renaissance. The critic's chief responsibility is to examine an author's resources of language and of genres, in a word, to be preoccupied with form. I've tried always to praise attempts to fashion the world anew, to hail daring and a commitment to the dynamism and dimensions of language. In many of these pieces, I come to an identical conclusion, that weak language is proof of weak ideas, that style is welded to substance, that the writer's fate is birthed by the writer's prose. When I see sum total or outward appearance or vast majority, unsolved mystery, or centered around or end result, my ink goes red. Such formulations announce that the writer doesn't mind sounding like everybody else. Fairness for the critic means giving a reliable, disinterested assessment of a writer's mind and prose, of how that mind and prose function in relation to literature, to the vibrant complexities of the canon. We must not speak of imaginative literature only in terms of the thematic. We must also attempt to confront the semantic, which includes the syntactic and the rhythmic. The technical and the ethical are not separate issues. Criticism endeavors to maintain the difference between mere disposition and strong argument, between simple opinion and hard-won judgment. Decisiveness is the thing, has always been the thing. It helps to have the heft of the canon behind your views. These essays proceed from the conviction that the right words matter. I've striven always to do writers the tremendous dignity of considering their minds, since the culture wants to do them the tremendous indignity of considering only their feelings. And language is our most accurate embodiment of mind. Henry James, the deepest quality of a work of art will always be the quality of the mind of the producer. With fiction writers, whatever else lies waiting in their toolbox, narrative, characterization, setting, dialogue, moral reckoning, etc., it is secondary to language, is rendered mute without first being in possession of the right words. Vigorous, exact, original. My title, American Audacity, is not meant to indicate that this is a catch-all compendium of American literature. Rather, it is a volume of essays and reviews concerned with American authors and with those American subjects I am interested in as an American author myself. A writer's interests, alas, are non-negotiable, nor are they always entirely explicable. I haven't been able to assent to Susan Sontag's ostensibly good definition of a writer as someone who's interested in everything. That's neither feasible nor advisable. Imagine the whiplash involved in sustaining an interest in everything. After being interested, I've tried to be interesting. What's interesting in a literary critic? precisely what's interesting in any language artist: force of vision, torque of phrase, depth of knowing, seriousness of humor, moral intelligence, a repudiation of herdthink, a dynamic assessment beyond the blurber's pet cliches of fascinating and brilliant, beyond the culture's prevailing platitudes in sophistry and insincerity. The language Mary McCarthy unforgettably calls a gruesome mass of rubble, and perhaps also a willingness to say what others will not in a manner others cannot. The topics and writers I deal with here are those I've been asked to write about by editors at various publications I esteem, and are those I've been attracted to because I thought I might have something useful to say about them. In some cases, I've had a fierce personal connection to the writer or topic, such as my piece on Catholic novelists, or the bibliophile, or the Boston Marathon bombing, or James Baldwin. Though I've tried always to maintain the disinterestedness Matthew Arnold says is essential to the critic. In other cases, such as my piece on Cynthia Ozick or Katie Royfe, I was delighted to have the opportunity to appreciate their work after long years of admiration. And in still other cases, such as my piece on Carl von Vechten and the Harlem Renaissance, I had to provide myself with a mini-education in the months before writing, since I had only the most rudimentary knowledge of the writer or subject. Indeed, I accepted many of these assignments because they afforded me the chance to correct a gap in my learning. When you write for magazines, you have to get used to certain compromises you might not like. Paragraphs get flipped or cut, prose gets fiddled with, punctuation fouled. Some essays appear here as I originally wrote them. Others have been shortened, others lengthened. Some titles have been changed. These days, the tag American appears to be stuck to every third book, TV show, or movie. But all American writers must, I think, at one point or another, pen their American book. This is mine. I seek to convert no one. My only wish is that fellow lovers of literature might find something here to argue with or admire. Cambridge, Massachusetts, 2018. American Moments. Creative Destruction. Let's forget about starving artist and get right to a more ominous conjugation. The artist in America is being starved, systematically and unashamedly. In this land of rumored bounty, there seems to be a bounty of another sort on the foreheads of serious middle-class writers and painters, musicians and illustrators, dancers and sculptors. If it's not a bounty identical to the one Comrade Stalin placed on the foreheads of certain Soviet-era artists, it nevertheless has an identical effect: silence, disappearance, unmanageable hardship for families. In his incisive analysis of this mess, Culture Crash, The Killing of the Creative Class, Scott Timberg delivers a potpourri of bleak statistics and appalling personal stories of talented and once thriving artists reduced to penury or making do, or else elbowed into different vocations entirely. One of the personal stories he relays is his own, which includes the now familiar plot points of being laid off from his job as a journalist, missing mortgage payments, and then having to endure the absurdist indignity of being sued by a bank whose girth is global. The locksmith who showed up to bar Timberg and his young family from their tiny home drove a car fancier and substantially newer than Timberg's own 17-year-old Honda. This is our world now, what we value, how we prioritize. Locksmiths earn stabler livelihoods than the arbiters and facilitators of culture. Renovate the overfamiliar trio making ends meet, and you'll be closer to the mark. Middle-class artists are meeting their ends. Although Timberg reports no incidents of literal starvation, you shouldn't doubt that crowds of one-time stable middle-class artists have been pummeled into the lower class, where they regularly feel the fangs of hunger. The marginalia in my copy of Culture Crash consists mostly of two words, good God. You are confronted by information so astounding, so soul-stomping, that you read on, hardly able to suppress moans of demoralization and barks of disbelief. You begin Timberg's book suspecting that things are bad. You finish it convinced that they've never been worse. Here's a paragraph grim enough to wreck your week, a handful of distressing figures culled directly from Timberg's scrupulous research. In the publishing and journalism trades, 260,000 jobs were nixed between 2007 and 2009. From 2009 to 2011, newspapers nixed 40,000 jobs. In 2009, 300 newspapers folded. Since the turn of the century, a mind-warping 80% of cultural critics writing for magazines and newspapers have been fired. There are only two remaining full-time dance critics in the entire United States of America. A not untypical yearly salary for a professional dancer is $15,000. Cellist composer Zoe Keating made $3,000 from 2 million YouTube views and nearly 500,000 streams on Spotify. Between 2008 and 2012, there were 66 number one songs, almost half of which were performed by only six artists: Katy Perry, Rihanna, Flo Rida, Black Eyed Peas, Adele, and Lady Gaga. Of a whopping 75,000 records released in 2010, 74,000 lost money or managed only to make back their production cost. At UCLA in 1966, 86% of students admitted that they valued a meaningful philosophy of life. By 2013, that percentage was amputated by half. Over the last two decades, the number of English majors graduating from Yale University has decreased by 60%. In American universities, 76% of faculty are adjuncts, low-paid laborers with no medical insurance, and barely a prayer to bolster them. According to Timberg, there are a mélange of culprits here, culprits with robust histories and not, as some pretend, a single and sudden culprit in the financial conflagration of 2008. There are the Hobbesian market forces, the consumer-propelled capitalism so lovely for behemoth corporations, who are its engine, but not so lovely for those poets and photographers who wish to maintain their integrity and intransigence outside the corporate system. There's the strafing autocracy of the Internet, which has led to a desperate restructuring of the music and publishing industries, and the necrosis of print. There's the long-standing and nationwide dedication to anti-intellectualism. There's the winner-take-all social credo that eradicates regard for any place other than first. Timberg calls it blockbuster culture. In the 1980s, Thomas Whiteside called it the blockbuster complex. There's an academic obscurantism, prevalent since the 1960s, that prods students away from the tonic pleasures of literature. And there's the widespread erroneous caricature of artists as eccentric idlers we might be better off without. The dearth of public funding for the arts, it mirrors the dearth of public ardor for the arts. At the same time, we're suffocating in artists, especially in writers. Toss a stone into any urban crowd and you'll hit a neophyte who's writing a novel. Yeats once opened his address to the Rhymers Club with, "Gentlemen, there are too many of us." And in the 1987 essay, Elizabeth Hardwick says this, "The charms of publication, the escalation of the discovery that almost anyone can be a writer, have been accompanied by a devaluation of the product required." If Hardwick were alive today, she'd be downright apoplectic. The very simple concept of supply and demand will not be debauched out of its simplicity. When everyone's an artist and no one spends much money on art, art is denuded of economic value, and most artists can't earn a living. As a member of the creative class, Timberg never harbored those gluttonous American ambitions of fame and wealth. he preferred this comparatively muted, sensible idea of success. I could get really good at something if I worked as hard as I could and surrounded myself with what someone once called, in a phrase that now sounds antique, the best that has been thought and said. The someone at the helm of that famous phrase is Matthew Arnold, and it appears in the preface to the 1875 edition of Culture and Anarchy. Culture is a pursuit of our total perfection by means of getting to know, on all the matters which most concern us, the best which has been thought and said in the world. That total perfection is a characteristically Arnoldian construction, and one that couldn't be penned today without the self-defeating smirk of irony. A critic of unstinting earnestness, Arnold never blushed when asserting his cultural idealism, an idealism tinged with spiritual urgency. Culture has but one great passion, the passion for sweetness and light. That marriage, sweetness and light, reaches our ears as slightly saccharine now, its cousin to Horace's requirement for art, dolce et utile, sweet and useful. But Arnold, being Arnold, remains wholly sincere. Culture seeks to make all live in an atmosphere of sweetness and light, and use ideas as it uses them itself, freely, to be nourished and not bound by them. For Arnold, culture is still connected to cultivation, to tillage, to agriculture, till, plant, reap, and be nourished. Arnold couldn't have failed to have in mind Candide's final words in Voltaire's novella, "We must cultivate our garden." In The Meaning of Culture from 1929, the English philosopher and novelist John Cooper Powys, writing a generation after Arnold, offers an updated version of Arnold's defense of culture, one that emphasizes the redoubtable benefits and felicities of art. "The aim of culture," Powys writes, "is to nourish within us," that word again, nourish, "a sturdy yet sensitive organism that shall be able to deal with the eternal recurrences of life and death." For Powys, the greatest of all obstacles to any deep, banked-up, sensitive culture is the inability to obtain leisure, the inability to be alone. And consider the present searing truth of that claim. How insidiously plugged in we all are, socially networked into an unsocial stupor, a mental truancy that teeters on the lip of catatonia. Powys sees the necessity of attaining a mind sensitive to rare and gentle things, a mind adequately armored against the frothy nothings of the hour. Those frothy nothings are no longer of the hour, but are much more insistent. They are of the second. "There is no escape from machinery and modern inventions," Powys writes, "no escape from the dictatorship of the uncultured," and if that is not entirely true, it's seemingly truer by the day, as our minuscule machines ding and ring, quack and quake in our pockets. Timberg understands that for generations with no memory of a world before the internet, there is no outside, no independent ledge from which to assess the madness. If Arnold undertook Culture and Anarchy in part as a response to the Industrial Revolution and its spirit-sapping tendencies, he denigrates our worship of machinery and our bondage to machinery and the faith in machinery, certain that culture looks beyond machinery. And Powys's The Meaning of Culture reacted to populist consumer vulgarity, then Timberg's culture crash wouldn't have been possible without the always hungry hydra of the internet. The net gets a bit of a lashing in this book, to be sure, but Timberg is aware of how effortlessly his study could have turned into an anti-internet diatribe, how instantaneously he'd be branded a technophobic hysteric, and so he's careful to point out, again and again, that the internet is not the only bandit guilty of filching livelihoods from middle-class artists. He's careful to show the confluence of factors, to show all the ill stars aligned to damn entire sectors of the creative class. He has no wish to banish our gadgets of distraction. When he advocates for the virtues of print, He doesn't mean that all print is sacrosanct, while online essays and reportage are organically besmirched, a position he knows is demonstrably untrue. Although you don't have to be a cyber-skeptic to see that you can't go online to read something without simultaneously being prodded to buy something. Online advertisers and retailers such as Amazon know that the difference between inquisitive and acquisitive has become a difference without much distinction. Rather, Timberg laments the disillusion of the print publication apparatus that allowed serious writers, editors, and photojournalists to maintain a middle-class life for themselves. If you were an artist subsisting on your copyrights, the revolution in IT vanquished that subsistence, as it vanquished so many bookstores and the bulk of the record industry. Timberg offers a concise tour of the Napster debacle, a reminder of how hard it was to sympathize with the record labels, those dreadnoughts whose galactic greed looked somewhat humble next to their hubris. If they couldn't exactly claim to have been blindsided by the net, they certainly weren't very quick to catch on. But unheardable bands such as Metallica shouldn't have been the focus of that polarizing eventuality. There were untold small and mid-level bands also signed to record labels, labels whose stewardship of those bands permitted them to remain in the middle class until Napster rushed in and snatched their earnings. What the ardent anti-internet scrum is slow to point out is that the problems associated with the net are not inherent to the net, but rather to the ways in which we use the thing, the ways in which we conceptualize it. Most writers and musicians won't earn a living online until we, the users, finally come around to the idea that we should buy what we read and hear on our computers, until we finally will ourselves from the clutches of complacency and indolence and lack of responsibility. This remains one of the egregiously democratizing effects of the net. We've come to think of most online content the way we think of oxygen. The human cost of free becomes clear, writes Timberg. Every day a publisher lays off staff, or a documentarian finds her film uploaded to YouTube without her permission. There's nothing stopping you from subscribing to a newspaper or magazine, from paying for your music and movies online, just as there's nothing stopping you from snapping shut your laptop and reaching for a hardback of Homer. It should be said, too, that implicit in Timberg's indictment of the net is his disconcerting suspicion that the thing is not only bad for the bank accounts of middle-class artists, but bad for the souls of us all. You've heard of all those shuttered bookstores, the already undervalued librarians, now thought members of the Pleistocene, the thinly attended performances of new musicians and artists because it burns fewer calories to stay home and Google something instead. The cyberspatial nooks we all live in have begun, says Timberg, to regard actual human beings and human interaction, its dynamism of merriment and conflict, is a crucial element to the creation of serious art. Timberg is particularly astute on the thriving art scenes experienced in Boston in the 1950s, Los Angeles in the 1960s, and Austin in the 1970s, the melange of factors that needed to converge in order for artists to flourish, including institutional support, low rents, a humming population in urban universities, an inviolable sense of a shared culture. And then on what happens when these cities are infiltrated by Hunnish bankers. When Robert Lowell was reconfiguring American poetry in 1950s Boston, a life of genteel poverty was still possible. Let me tell you, as a Bostonian, a life of genteel poverty is no longer possible, and hasn't been for quite some time. American individualism has come to resemble a kind of hermetism, each artist before his own effulgent machine, without lifelines to his fellow strivers and makers, his community. The roiling and reciprocal group, so central to the early achievements of Lowell and Plath and Sexton, has been replaced by a synthetic community online, or by the cloistered academic department, which is how many artists in America, if they're the fortunate ones, are able to remain in the middle class. But when you're an artist in academia, you're only a part-time artist at best. Patti Smith, says Timberg, was ultimately able to commit her life to music because of an infrastructure, a network of clubs, music labels, and publishers, an infrastructure that has been dismantled for more than a decade now. We've fled our public places of reciprocity and dialogue and jettisoned any commitment to a joint culture. After the upheavals of the 1960s, our polycultural ethos was codified first in American universities and then in the workplace and entertainment. But, says Timberg, for culture to work, we need a common language, and it's impossible to have one when we are becoming more culturally and economically divided every day. No wonder our common language has become celebrity gossip and reality TV. America's celebrity scourge, that Tinseltown bacchanalia of beauty, youth, and bathos, had invaded our living rooms long before the net showed up. In the 1980s, the term couch potato was never marshaled as insultingly as it should have been, as entire zip codes were vegetized by Ted Turner and Entertainment Tonight. At the hub of this mess is how we as a nation perceive the artist. Timberg quotes the cretinous opinions of market enthusiasts in Kentucky, who, after the Louisville Orchestra was pestled into bankruptcy, posted comments such as, "Pack your fiddles and go home, boys and girls. Maybe find real jobs." Timberg urges us away from this bamboozled and deadening state in which we permit the market to dictate the value of things. The spirit-ennobling energies of poetry and classical music will never measure on Wall Street. Remember Ossip Mandelstam's quip about how Russia respects her poets enough to murder them? We'd be in much better stead as a people if we began to value our poets as much. Of all the realities chronicled in Culture Crash, what would the worst manifestation of the worst realities look like? No new art but corporate-driven celebrity kitsch. Essayistic advertisements tapped out by algorithms. The annihilation of independent ideas and the thriving of ideological herdthink. An aesthetical tundra everywhere, a society of Philistines, tranquilized by the trivial, in Kierkegaard's phrase. And what is the most we can hope for? What would the best manifestation look like? If worse comes to worst, is only slightly more exasperating than if better comes to best, and the best is far from good enough. Artists of independence and seriousness and transgression must not be debased into having to choose between nothing and nothing much. On December 12th of last year, Americans for the Arts emailed its supporters some buoyant news for a badly damaged ship, a buck-up for arts advocacy. The night before, the U.S. House of Representatives, in the midst of its characteristic convulsions and incompetence, and by dint of some abracadabra, managed to pass a spending bill it dubbed Cromnibus, which sounds rather like a beast from Homer, but is an alloy of the continuing appropriations resolution and an omnibus bill. The $1 trillion government funding included nearly $300 million for the NEA and the NEH, $30 million for the Office of Museum Services, $25 million for Arts and Education, and $445 million for the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. If you squinted during the midterm elections last year, you might have spotted some morsels among the famine. Citizens of Utah, the great red bastion of the West, voted for 6 ballot initiatives that would augment arts programs, and Rhode Islanders voted for $35 million to be distributed to various arts organizations across the state. Anorexic, though they may seem beside the obese information revealed in Culture Crash, and irrelevant as they may be when it comes to individual artists surviving year to year in a society that doesn't care if they perish, those facts and numbers nevertheless look miraculous, an indication that perhaps all is not lost. The American hatred of literature and art did not develop all by itself, but is an outcrop of odium generis humani, an unconscious loathing of what is human and an unwillingness to understand ourselves. Still, Timberg has no choice but to end culture crash with a modest toll of uplift, just as some have no choice but to find meaning in life after they learn that the cosmos is an achingly pointless accident. His rallying cry amounts to more of a rallying whisper. He has no blueprint for betterment, though his final lines are a lovely picture of the world he'd like to live in. The journalist can't be faulted for coming up short on solutions. His mission is to report from the ditch, to slap us awake to the carnage stacking up around us. Because the artist's woe has its origin in Washington and on Wall Street, in the very steel of our socio-economic structure, and in the ceaseless buzzing of the electronic marketplace, reversing that woe will take a revolution. In the meantime, poke your elected representatives on the shoulder and say you won't be voting for them again unless they have a cure for this pox upon the serious middle-class artist. Donate to arts advocacy organizations. Purchase physical books from independent and used bookstores. Hide your face in shame should you partake of pirated music. Keep your mouse off Kim Kardashian's ass. If you believe that the life of your mind is inseparable from the health of your life, that serious art and artists are an essential component of human nourishment, then you have an obligation to yourself and your children, and us all, to do something about the grave circumstances Timberg sets before you. The New Republic, February 2015. The Problem of the Catholic Novelist. It's not altogether easy being a Catholic, and it's immeasurably harder being a novelist. So you might imagine the myriad conundrums of being both. The French critic Charles de Beau, writing about novelist François Mauriac in 1933, dubbed this Le Problème du Romancier Catholique, the problem of the Catholic novelist. And what a whopping problem it remains. In his 1984 essay, How to Be an American Novelist in Spite of Being Southern and Catholic, Walker Percy writes of when his publisher requested that he cut the subtitle of his 1971 novel, Love in the Ruins, because it contained the term bad Catholic. The suggestion being, says Percy, that the word Catholic, even bad Catholic, might put people off. Percy is irked by this for the very simple and truthful reason that being a Catholic writer is not dishonorable. And then he rather understatedly mentions Dante and Cervantes. When we brand a novel Catholic, says Percy, that brand entails a tighter and more inclusive semantic bonding than if the novel were branded Protestant. Percy means that in multiple regions across this land, and in the Northeast especially, Protestant equals WASP, which rather conveniently equals American. Updike and Cheever are nothing if not unerringly, unflinchingly American. In Updike's story, Sunday Teasing, the Updike stand-in says, I'm an American, 11th generation German, white, Protestant, Gentile, small town, middle class, I am pure American. Otherwise, what would a strictly Protestant novel look like? One can comprehend fiction with a Calvinist bent. Of course, you see the Calvinist vision of sin in Melville and Hawthorne. But how about a thoroughly Episcopalian or Presbyterian novel? These mild-mannered, watered-down denominations tend not to warp the artistic protocol of imaginative writers. If a novel were packaged as evangelical, you'd ready yourself for the eschatological dross of the Left Behind series, those abominations with the palsied prose and subliterate grasp of Christian tradition. Catholic is not evangelical, no, but regarding tags for novelists, it's not far off. The hocus-pocus and peacock plumage are tough to hide. Percy suspects his fellow Southerners of thinking Catholicism the most florid and vulgar of the lot. Repulsion by a Catholic tag, writes Percy, lies in the assumption that there is something more than ethnicity or regionism involved, because the same prospective reader is evidently not put off by the ethnic Jewishness of, say, a Malamud, or a Roth, or a Bellow. That something is called religion, and for whole swathes of American culture and spiritual history, Catholicism has been ripe for divisiveness and suspicion. One can be a Jew sans religion, but what would an unbelieving Catholic look like? More to the point, you won't find a novel by Malamud or Roth or Bellow subtitled The Adventures of a Bad Jew. And even if you did, you wouldn't have to prep yourself to be preached at. Revisit Roth's story, The Conversion of the Jews, to see for yourself. Admit it, Catholics can be a pushy lot, given to unrequested advice about the state of your soul and the state of your sperm, while Jews have no personal or doctrinal interest in proselytizing. They are not inflected by didacticism, and so they don't care if you convert or not. The intellectual and didactical substance of Judaism, wed to the cultural and ethnical elements of Jewishness, rescue the Jewish novelist from the pigeonholed perdition into which the Catholic novelists are easily tossed. Published 14 years after Percy converted to Catholicism, his first novel and masterwork, The Moviegoer, won the National Book Award in 1962. If you didn't know how integral Catholic faith was to Percy's life and thought, and if you don't read novels with Catholicism on the brain, as you shouldn't, then you wouldn't be certain of it from The Moviegoer. Binks Bowling, a veteran of the Korean War and a New Orleans stockbroker, is about to hit 30. He's fond of females, money, and movies, and feels alternately taxed with a murky ennui, with a muted awareness of how pointless his days are, and with having to help his lovely cousin Kate navigate her emotional upheaval. Existential is the always modish tag bandied about to describe the crisis of characters such as Binks and Kate, except that what ails them is much more particular, more personally dire than what that catch-all knee-jerk term denotes. Despair gets nearer the mark. It's the term Binks himself employs throughout his telling. The book's epigraph is by Kierkegaard, who had large effects on Percy. The specific character of despair is precisely this. It is unaware of being despair. Peppered throughout the novel are indications of the partial Catholicity of what Binks articulates as his search for meaning, what anyone would undertake if he were not sunk in the everydayness of his own life. His mother is a devout Catholic, which, he says, accounts for the fact that I am, nominally at least, also a Catholic, although not a practical Catholic. Binks, like Percy himself, was raised Presbyterian, and by practical, he means both practicing and his difficulty in buying the precepts of a most impractical church. The success of The Moviegoer lies in Percy's thorough command of his material, in his linguistic pitch and narrative register, the expertly modulated disaffection of Binks' voice, his gift of phrase, the novel's equipoise of humor and spiritual entropy. Percy doesn't wallop you with sermonizing or with the doctrinal understanding of despair, the sin of shunning God's grace, the very sin for which Faustus is hurled hellward, or the leaden piety, or with a novelized hodgepodge of Catholic dogma. In addition to his despair, Binks references his malaise, that globe-trotting pain of loss that restricts itself to no denomination, no theism. The world is lost to you, the world and the people in it, and there remains only you and the world, and you no more able to be in the world than Banquo's ghost. Percy's religio-artistic program devolved in the decades after The Moviegoer. As his Catholicism became more entrenched, as he became more fixated on penning the great American Catholic novel, and he never again composed a book as good as his first, not The Last Gentleman from 1966, and not The Second Coming from 1980. The two novels that came closest to fulfilling the extraordinary promise made by the moviegoer. In How to Be an American Novelist, in spite of being Southern and Catholic, you'll find proof of what went wrong for him. From a Catholic perspective, at least, Christianity is a belief inherently congenial to the vocation of the novelist in a way in which, say, Buddhism, Marxism, Freudianism, behaviorism is not. To say so offends the conventional wisdom that dogma constrains the freedom of the artist. The word dogma, of course, has gotten to be a swear word and is used pejoratively. Whereas what it signifies, of course, is simply belief in the central Christian mysteries. For example, the incarnation. In this sense, dogma is a guarantee of the mystery of human existence, and for the novelist, a warrant to explore the mystery. You can count the logic problems in that passage. Buddhism and Marxism, and the other quite naturally, come equipped with their own breed of dogmas, if dogmas are what you're looking for. He also doesn't mind being sophistic there, since he knew that dogma entails the unthinking acceptance of authoritative assertions, many of which would crumble to ash beneath a moment's scrutiny. He can't renovate the definition to cheer himself up. And why would a novelist require a dogma such as the incarnation as a warrant, a permission to probe the enigmas of human living? Why not just probe them? You don't need a monotheistic guarantee of mystery. Your fellow humans will furnish it for you every day. Don't worry. When you consider that Percy was only a teen when his parents were killed, his father by suicide, his mother by car wreck, and that as a young doctor he himself nearly died of tuberculosis, you'd think he would have had plenty of novelistic Sturm und Drang, ample fuel for his fiction, outside the dogmas of Catholic faith. The truth is that by Catholic, Percy appears to mean something much more encompassing than what the rest of us mean. In his essays on the subject, there's usually the tension of simultaneously embracing and repudiating the tag Catholic novelist, a strain of self-defense seething beneath the ostensibly objective contentions, tinges of overcompensation, as if he's laboring to convince himself. Referring to Flannery O'Connor at one point, Percy contends that the truly Catholic writer knows that it is only through the particularities of place, time, and history that the writer achieves his art. Why would it take a truly Catholic writer to figure out what good writers have always known? E.B. White advises, "Don't write about man, write about a man," is a tad baffling. But Percy's suggestion in the passage is right on and worth underlining. A novel fails if it attains no more than another played-out simulacrum of reality, another yawningly obedient take on the way we live now. If it doesn't attempt some mode of agon with the holy, some stab at the sacred, an effort at touching the sublime, the transformation of the quotidian into necessary mystery. Imaginative literature imparts a version of living that is fuller, richer, wiser, and more complete than what is available to us in our everyday dealings. Still, Percy's view of dogma is confusing because recourse to dogma is precisely how a genuinely Catholic novel would falter. This is what Harold Nemirov means when he writes, "Art by vision and not by dogma, patiently and repeatedly offers the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen." By virtue of its age and pageantry and rituals, its parading of abracadabra and the supernatural, Catholicism is nothing if not a denomination of dogma. The linguistic and narrative maneuvers of the Catholic novelist, his artistic intent, have at hand explanations, ready-made motives, and so his characters tend to be robbed of complete and unique individual agency, of their own necessarily individual will. For the truly Catholic novel, There's only one way to read it, the Catholic way. And any novel that can be read only one way isn't a novel, but an advertisement, or worse, agitprop. If you want to know the aim of the avowedly Catholic novelist, the aim of his characters, of his storytelling sensibility, just check in with the Gospels, the sacraments, the papacy, the Holy Ghost, the liturgy, the Mass. The Catholic novelist must, by definition, come to the novel with his epistemology embedded like a tick, his ontology fully explicable by deference to his faith and to the Church. This is connected to what I.A. Richards and A.C. Bradley once argued, that as long as redemption through Christ is possible, there can be no such thing as a Christian tragedy. Inside a Catholic novel, water, bread, and blood are helpless not to have allegorical import. They can never just be water, bread, and blood, and that's a damning disadvantage for any writer. I experience all this rather more acutely than I'd like. After my first novel appeared in 2011, the late D.G. Myers, an Orthodox Jew and literary critic with formidable erudition, began writing about it in the pages of Commentary magazine, and on his own vehicle of literary comment, a commonplace blog. It's true that the narrator of that novel once refers to himself as a lapsed Catholic, and at one point engages in a nonsense dialogue with his boyhood priest. The book is a comedy. But that, for me, was the extent of the novel's Catholicity. Myers, however, detected a Catholic program in the very plinths and joists of the novel's architecture, in the very wiring of the narrative sensibility. By the time my second novel was released, in 2014, Myers wrote about it for the Christian bi-monthly Books and Culture. He had been referring to me as a Catholic novelist for 3 years. We'd developed a tender camaraderie of opposites, and in one email, in which he rightly refers to me as a cradle Catholic, he writes, "You'll never be able to shake off the early dousing in the language of the Church. It cracked your voice for good." When the first book landed on a list of Catholic novels worth reading, when the second book received attention from religious-minded critics at venues such as Commonwealth and First Things, when a priest wrote to ask permission to adopt the novel into a play, when I began receiving invitations to speak at Catholic conferences and to write for Catholic magazines, I felt an uptick in those tremors of ambivalence I'd been having since Myers had sallied into my life. On the one hand, the American novelist has tremendous appreciation for any attention at all, such as the chasmal regard our nation has for the novel, and when that attention gives off a sophisticated literary and religious sheen, the novelist has much more than mere appreciation. It feels something akin to a blessing. On the other hand, I haven't been a believing Catholic in over 20 years. Sometime after my 18th birthday, I saw that Aquinas was no match for Nietzsche, and then Augustine lost by knockout to Hume. Orwell, in an unfinished essay on Waugh, hops right to the point when he says that one cannot really be Catholic and grown up. My guess is that at the idealistic age of 18, I was distractedly concerned with being all grown up, with putting away those childish things. Corinthians, when I became a man, I put away childish things. So, as grateful as I was for the percipient views of religious-minded critics, such as Myers, I felt something of a fraud, as well as something of a challenge. Not only to clarify myself the ways in which my Catholic past might overtly and covertly surge inside my fiction, but to declare or dismiss my fidelity to the Church. No honest, self-aware novelist denies the unconscious mechanisms at work and play in his composition, or attempts to refute the insistent facts of his past, facts that heave and breathe in his sentences, in his apprehensions of art.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.